Sarah, you've been so introduced with the idea of Live Simply, so it's a real pleasure to have Jed Edwards. Does everybody know Jed from the Capital Office?
Nice to meet you.
He's going through the bulk of the work.
Thank you. But,
thank you.
I'm going to just start things off.
Nice to be back here.
So the programme is there on Mike Fitzsimon. Do you speak Liverpool from being there? He was such a witness now, anyway. So the plan for this evening is we'll start with a prayer, a Live Simply prayer, and then we'll work on the instructions. Then a short talk about what we've been doing so far at St. Anne's. And then Jed is going to talk to us about the whole idea of Live Simply, the theological background and so forth. And then we'll split into groups around our tables to have a discussion about ideas, really, about what we might do. And then at the end, we'll have a little think about how to do things. Jed's brought, we found post-it notes on your table.
I've got them.
We've got post-it notes. If you have ideas, put them on post-it notes, and then at the end we can stick them on the board there. And we can have a vote. It's a bit like, is it Strictly Come Dancing?
Just want you to pull the wrong one out of the envelope, you're alright.
We aim to finish it with a prayer and home at 8:30. So without further ado, Father God, would you like to lead us in the Live Simply?
Actually, just before I do that, one, I make apologies for going and slipping out soon. But the other is to say, Jed, I discovered last year, and we met, and I didn't realise that for 20-odd years he'd been living down the road, and in 1980, he and Father Boniface and I were colleagues at Dowie School, and we...
Happy days.
They were. And I just... Anyway, it was lovely to catch up with him and discover the fantastic work that he's doing, because... Actually, I don't think that our parish needs a huge amount of inspiration because we've got such committed people here. And I remember when I came to the parish, I said, don't expect me to come to all your meetings, but you really have a place of priority in the parish life. And it's the likes of the people involved in Justice and Peace Group who I hope will really put us into acting. And as somebody who needs pushing into things, I really do. Appreciate what they do. So, and thanks very much, Sue, for organising tonight with you, Jeff.
You should have copies of the Live Simply prayer. I think we should say this again. Thank you very much. It's really lovely to see people from St. Elizabeth's Stadium. It's not to organise us at St. Anne's just because we close the home, really, but hopefully it could be a whole parish thing. We can all get stuck in. So, shall we?
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Compassionate and loving heart.
We praise the world for our souls to share, a world of beauty and humanity, creating us a desire to live simply, so that our lives may reflect your generosity. Creator God, you gave us responsibility for the earth, a world of riches and delights, creating us a desire to live sustainably, so that those who follow after us may enjoy the fruits of your creation. God of peace and justice, you give us the capacity to change, to bring about a world that mirrors your wisdom, creating us the desire to act in solidarity, so that those of injustice crumble, and those now crushed are set free. Amen.
So,
we're
going to start with what is Live Simply? How many people have heard of Live Simply? It's a Catholic initiative, and it arose really in 2015. Pope Francis brought out an encyclical letter called Laudato Si, which I know I can see around the room. People have had some study sessions about Laudato Si last year and the year before, and it was really very. It's the only time I've ever read an encyclical all the way through. I'm ashamed to say, but it's a really urgent call to all of us to act on the crisis of climate change that threatens the whole world and has a disproportionate effect on people in poor countries. And in response to that, CAFOD have brought out the idea of the Live Simply Award, which is something that parishes can work to gain, usually over about a year. But the idea is that we attempt to live simply, to live sustainably, and to live in solidarity with the poor. And in each of those boxes, we should have one big action, which is either a big change or a smaller change, as lots of people do, and then two smaller actions. There's nine altogether. It doesn't all have to be new things. You know, we can count things that are already going on. And one of the things that we were thinking was it's a great idea of finding out what is already going on in the parishes. Often there's a lot going on that your one group knows about and other people don't. So we can use stuff we're already doing. But obviously we need to do a few more things as well. And really, this evening is about finding out what's already going on and ideas for new things that we can do. So we studied the Lent course last year, and there's another Lent course coming up which is based on this. People might remember coming to hear Father Dan Haran, you know, the American Franciscan, explaining Laudato Si. They were very good, weren't they? So the call is urgent. Other parishes around the country are doing it. So we thought, could we do it? Well, why not? Let's give it a go. Other parishes have done it, have found it quite challenging, but they've also found that they've been surprised how much they've achieved. And one of the effects of it has been to really bring people together and not be just something that you do for a year, but something that brings about a lasting change in parish life, because people have come together, perhaps in ways it wouldn't have done before. I think we probably know so much already and do so much already. We should capitalise on that and share the information and knowledge we already have. Share our ideas, find ways that we can work together and sort of strengthen each other by doing that, and then take on some new challenges. We've done a few things already. We've established a sort of little subgroup from just a peace group and some other people to try to organise things a little bit. We've discussed the idea with Father Godric and Father Boniface in the parish council. They've been really very encouraging. We've bombarded poor Father Godric with all our mad ideas. There are some posters in the church at St. Anne's which could easily go to St. Elizabeth's once she's been decorated. Mother Black Parlour, who's an infant school teacher, has made them. They're really effective. We've put a box in the porch, also made by Margaret, for people to put their ideas in. And we put something in the bulletin, which hopefully people have seen. And when I get around to actually sending it, we'll have some information on the parish website, which will include the links through to those talks by Father Dan Haran, going for about a quarter of an hour. They're really very good. So it's interesting what's going on already. We know already that the prayer group have used Lampedusa across liturgy. You brought the cross with you today. The UCM are also planning to do it. We're already using low energy light bulbs in the church. We already use fair trade tea and coffee after Mass, so we send money to Marian Care, and you all know that, don't you, Terry, to Marian Care in Southport, Calais. We had a volunteers party recently, we had fair trade wine, and we did the toiletries collection, which again we've done every year for the last few years, just after Christmas for Asylum Week, and that went down very well when the stuff was taken down there. So they're just some of the things that we already do. So strange, isn't it? At the moment, it hasn't tried so badly. Stephen and John Hunt are doing an audit of bulletins to see, you know, can we print fewer, get a better idea, how many we need so we're not wasting them. And we had tonight's meeting with Jed. We've got a fair trade breakfast coming up on the 5th of March, which again, there's a Lent course starting at St. Elizabeth's in the next week. Is it next week, Mary? Yes. So your ecumenical project could tell us this about later. We'll also be doing a Live Simply themed Lent course here on Friday nights, starting next week. What's the date for you, Darius? On the 31st of March, we've got a talk on organic farming and how to do your garden up so it's good for wildlife, which is a fundraiser for the week. And then in the end of May, we've got a joint meeting coming up with the UCM, where there's a lady who's got lots of dealings with an orphanage in Bangladesh will be coming to tell us about that. So there's a few things already going on. The Lent courses, the St. Elizabeth's Ecumenical one at St. Mark's. Do you want to say a word about that, Mary?
Yeah, this year we're doing it around the Tom Hanks film, where he's actually in transit between his home country and another country, and there's a coup in his home country, so he gets stuck in the airport. So basically it's a lot of themes about migrants and refugees and what it feels like to be in a place where you haven't got a job and you haven't got any money. So that's the course that we're going to be doing with St. Mark's for 5 weeks.
So the course here will be, I don't know if anybody came on the Lent course last year, but it's the same sort of format. We've got bits of Laudato Si, gospel readings, prayers and stories and plenty of scope for discussions, nothing in here. And that's 7 to 7.30, but Friday to the 10th of March, 5 weeks again, same as the social groups. I think Steve Allerton's daughter drew this, it's the Corporal Works of Mercy, and the Spiritual Works of Mercy.
I think it's going to be like a nation of sin.
So when we go to the group, we need to actually officially sign up with CAPOL. And then really it's a matter of involving as many people as possible and generating some new ideas and activities and sharing information about what's already happening. So there'll be scope later on for an ideas session. Hand over to Jeff now. He's coming machine.
Coming machine. Thanks, Susan.
Jeff, we've sorry to interrupt you before.
Yes, of course.
On Friday, we've got this little service at 7 o'clock with an amp producer cross. Are you going to bring it back or leave it? Or?
I can leave it here.
And is it, have you got a service already?
The stuff in the box.
It's
all.
The box?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Nice to check that.
Well, thanks, Susan. And it's really nice to meet you all. I think some of you have seen before and faces familiar from last time. Susan asked me to look a little bit at the theological aspect of it. I won't spend long on this because we're in the presence of decent theologians. But one of the models that we think about particularly in justice and peace work really comes from a way, way back and was encapsulated in this piece of Catholic social teaching from Paul VI in 1971. And he said, it's up to Christian communities to analyse the situation that they're in with objectivity, to shed on it the light of the Gospel's unalterable words, and to draw the principles of reflection on the judgment and directives for action from the social teaching of the Church. Which means see, judge and act. We have a look at what's going on, we judge it, and then we take action based upon that. Pastoral cycle for those who know. And if we have a look at that C bit, we might recognise some of this, hopefully you do. Here in northwestern England, the true standards of living for many parts of the world, including ourselves, hopefully, there is rising inequality in some parts of the world. And you can recognise those other things about consumerism, about levels of waste. Climate change affecting people, particularly those in on coastal districts and the poles. Environmental degradation, Pope Francis has a lot to say about that, Susan referred to. And with the effects of that, you're going to get increased migration and issues about identity, where people are from and where they want to belong to. And is a little bit on the signs of climate change, because Laudato Si is much more than about climate change. It's about our relationship with each other, about our relationship with the planet. But these are the signs that Pope Francis was very familiar with. Global warming is a natural effect that warms up the earth, and we need it to do that. But if we add more greenhouse gases, then the earth gets hotter, because it's a thicker layer. The heat can't escape back out to space, a bit like a greenhouse. So what happens then is that the models that the scientists have generated predict an increase in the overall Earth temperatures, a quite dramatic increase, particularly in the Northern Hemisphere. How do we know those models work? Well, we don't, of course. We can't predict the future. But the best way of doing that is to look backwards. So if you've got the models and they say that they'll go in this direction, what would happen if they went backwards? And they have the models which seem to work best are these pink lines here, which is the global temperature, which takes into effect our impact on the planet, not just the impact of other of the natural phenomena, but also our impact. And that's the best or most accurate description of the way that the temperatures of the Earth have been going over recent decades, since about 1900. So this is all looked at by the UN's Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, and have done a series of most detailed reports, and you'll be familiar with statistics. I'm sure 95% of the Earth scientists think that this is happening and that we're responsible for it. You might remember the very hot summer of 2003 and the very significant difficulties that caused, particularly on the continent. It's bad up here, but it's very difficult in parts of France and so forth. Very significant economic losses. Lots of people died in addition to what they would have done. And yet, if you have a look at that information, this is an IPCC used material. This is from the UK Climate Impacts Programme. And that's the 2003 peak in temperature in the summer. But by 2050, that will be an average summer. And by 2080 here, it will be quite a cool one. So you've got a temperature range here from naught, where currently what is about 1900, and then a rise of 2 to 6 degrees. And some of those models are predicting around about a 4 degrees, 5 degrees rise by 2100. So that's going to be a very significant change to the way that the world is at the moment. Massive movements of people around the globe, and then people obviously reacting to that. And our grandchildren, great-grandchildren, will be part of that. It's unavoidable. Well, there's a secret. That's what Pope Francis looked at when he wrote Laudato Si. And he asked us to judge. What does the scripture say? What does social teaching say? There are hundreds of references in scripture. I'll just take one of the earliest ones here about Genesis, from Genesis 1:26. And God said, let us make man and mankind in our own image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the heavens and the livestock and all over the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. And of course, when the Genesis writers were putting these stories together, there wasn't such a thing as climate change and all the rest. But I think you can see the fundamental message there, which is that the earth is a gift from God, and that we are its stewards. It's our responsibility to live here and to pass it on in a safe environment to future generations and also to future creatures. It's really important. Susan mentioned Pope Francis' appeal, Laudato Si, and this is it, if you boil it down to four lines. The urgent challenge to protect our common home, which is what he refers to it as a subtext, Laudato Si, on the care of our common home. The urgent challenge to protect our common home includes a concern to bring the whole human family together to seek a sustainable and integral development, which means that we don't just treat the rich people, we don't just treat the poor people, we don't treat just animals, we treat everything together, the whole earth together. And that's why it's much more than about climate change. Okay, so here's the judging bit. We know we need to do something. But very often we say to each other, you know, well, actually, how? I know something needs to be done, but how? It's just too big, we're just on our own, what can we do? Individuals can act, yes, but where do we get the information from? Who do we trust? How can we be encouraged? How, you know, it's difficult. And what do we do first? Those, I'm sure, are very familiar questions. And there are lots of questions. And all the time we seem to be stuck because we're part of the system in which we are living. We all benefit from that inequality. That's a fact. Church theologians call that structural sin. We're in a situation where we're lucky because we are not suffering as much as other people are suffering. But the Lord asks us to respond, and to respond in love, not in guilt, because if we respond in guilt, we won't sustain that action. We need to find that place in our hearts, in our heads, which says, actually, this isn't right. There's something here I want which is better. I want better for my community, I want better for the world, I want better for animals, and better for whatever it might be. But it's a response based on love which will make the difference. So why respond, even though we said all that, okay, but convincement is a process, isn't it? We can do certain things, we take little baby steps, that's what we do. Hopefully tonight will help. But why should the church respond? I'll give you an example. We perhaps sometimes are sitting in a bubble ourselves of just the church. In 2009, I was part of a group that wrote a strategy for Cheshire West and Chester called Vision 2050, A Sustainable Future for the County. And a guy came along to present it called Maya Hillman, who's quite an advanced, well-respected environmentalist, and he said that people don't particularly listen to scientists, and they don't really like or listen to politicians very much. And he wasn't talking to us he was talking to a secular audience, and he said that people listen to faith-based communities. They listen to us. Why? Because we haven't got an axe to grind. We're talking from fairly altruistic positions, and we also are talking from community, because we're here tonight, we talk to each other. That's very important, and that's, I guess, reflected in what MPs say. So why do MPs listen? Because we've elected them, we put them there. They have to say and do something other than what the party whips say. But the MPs, if you ask them, will say, actually, if a Catholic community or any community, but particularly a faith-based community, says something, they listen to it more than perhaps there are some lobbyists, whatever, they'll listen to. But they listen to us. Why? They listen to us because they know we belong and we're not grinding an axe. Okay? We're doing things on an altruistic point of view. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So this idea that we aren't very strong, we actually are. We just don't bother to exercise that power. A bit like the co-op. It's this sleeping giant, isn't it? Well, we're like that. Maybe it goes back to emancipation, I don't know, but we're still keeping our heads down too much.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's time. Is, as Pope Francis said, it's urgent. We need to do something about it. Okay. And we are the church. That's what our charism is. That's what our baptism is about. And when we do speak out, usually with other people, people remember the Make Poverty History campaign around the 20 around the millennium. So in 15 years, Make Poverty History wiped out third world debt. That's billions and billions, trillions of dollars. And in 15 years, people campaigned and they wiped out third world debt. It would take CAF, or somebody's calculated, 355 years to bring in the money that it would have needed. And then campaigning achieved that in 15 years. So don't doubt our own power, is what I'm saying. How you use it is important, but don't doubt that you have it and that people actually want to hear your views. Yeah. So here's the sustainable future. Oh yes, I've got one other thing to say. I was at the UN Climate Change Conference. We did a bike ride from Dieppe to Paris last November. It was great fun. And we got there at the point where the church, the faith community's position from around the world was presented to the person in charge of the UN's climate change unit. And you can just see there are 1.78 million signatures from around the world. 1.8 million signatures from around the world. 40,000 from CAFORD and TROCA and SCIAF fans, or supporters. And they were, you can't see this too well, so it's a bad picture, but I've kept it in for a reason. And this is the person who we presented them to. She was then the executive secretary of the United Nations Climate Change Unit. She was leading the conference. Cristiana Figueres, and she started the conference by saying that when she received the position, she said, "I've been told I'm not to cry." This is a senior civil servant from Costa Rica. She was marked. Well, what she said, there she is in the middle. And you might remember that famous picture with the, what's his name, with the rubber green hammer, calling the conference to an end. That petition was a very significant part of the ability of the negotiators to say that we need a better deal for the poorer nations on the earth. And because faith communities, only two million people signed those petitions, but because of that, she said that made a really, really significant impact. Now, that's all the governments, all the nations across the world, 2 million people. Only 40,000 from the UK. Okay. Now, if you can affect international policy by signing a petition, okay, it doesn't always work. I know that, but it shows the power that we have. Okay, so what's the significance of all that? Well, the big move, one of the biggest things about the UN climate change deal was the trying to get the move, the market, to buy less coal and oil and fossil fuels and prevent the greenhouse gas problems. Not by fossil fuels, gas, oil and coal. And to move towards renewable energy, because if you could demonstrate it, if the market showed that renewable energy was much more secure, then people aren't going to invest in the other stuff. Okay, it's as simple as that. Well, back here in the northwest of Liverpool Archdiocese, the Archdiocese is part of IFM, which is the Intradiocesan Fuel Management System, and all the dioceses get together and they try to negotiate a cheaper deal for their energy and stuff. Okay, this is part of IFM's deal. And 16, I think it's probably more than that now, of the dioceses get their energy from renewable sources, and we're one of them. So Liverpool Archdiocese gets its in its schools, not in its schools, in its churches and its clubs from renewable sources. And they've done that together. So the diocese is leading away. Does that make sense? The diocese is leading away. So we could respond to that. We can respond to that individually, if we chose to. Because the more we push and buy non-fossil fuels, the more the investment will come into renewable sources. Okay. So by coming together, we can know what we've already done, Susan has said, share our ideas and take action sustainably, and achieve more and keep going. We can bring other people with us and celebrate. Well, how do we do that? We all want that. We can't do it very well on our own, but we can do it together. Okay, so this is a little bit about the Live Simply Award. This is not an attempt for you to become cathodized. That's not what this is about. This is a process which is for parishes to become, to live simply. We all need to do that. Catholic just happens to recognize this. So I'm not going to tell you, you've got to support, you've got to donate to CAFOD's appeals or whatever. Catholic parishes, schools and communities can respond. Okay. It unites people around common concerns, so we can see together what's actually going on in our area, nationally and internationally. And it encourages people to judge together, in our tradition, not in the tradition of the Daily Mail or the Daily Mirror or the Guardian, in the Catholic tradition. Not exclusively, but in the Catholic tradition. It encourages us to change and make a difference, to act, to make a difference, and recognises and celebrates what we've achieved. Okay. Now, the actual award isn't really important. If you think it is, then it isn't. That's what I'm not telling you. It's only a piece of wood. It's not that important. What's important is what you decide to do and the way you are together with each other. That's what's important. What you discover yourselves about what's going on. Think, well, we're a great community. We really, really do care about the poor. We do things for Asylum Link. We do things for the food bank. Okay. That's what's important. And then taking a next step based upon that action that you know is really, really solid. So, living simply, following Pope Francis' words, urgent appeal, sustainably with creation and in solidarity with people in poverty. How do you go about it? We've covered this, I'll just go through it quickly. This is the generic one, so you've already done some of this. Have a look on the website, the Live Simply part of the Catholic website. Get involved with 23 of us, I think, in here tonight, which is marvellous. Both Boniface and Godric are here tonight. I can call them by the first name. and then you see what's happening. We're judging as we are going along. And then the group that's come to sign up, they're not committing themselves, you know, they're committing to be part, on behalf of the parish, to be part of the Live Simply community of parishes across England and Wales. You won't believe how simple the action plan is. because the action plan is actually in your heads and in your hearts. That's what it is. It's not on a piece of paper. There are some basic things, and that's what it's all about. We invite you to join us for Live Simply. The community needs to plan, as Susan said, one substantial Live Simply, Live Sustainably, Live in Solidarity, and two minor ones. So 9 actions, and that can be something that you're already doing. Okay, so if you were looking at something like living in solidarity, this parish is, or both parishes, are tremendously supportive of CAFOD at the moment. So that's you trying to live in solidarity with people. Yeah? That makes sense? So you might say, well, we'll do a bit more of that. We'll support an SVP project or whatever it is. Does that make sense? Okay. Think about what your community already does then, about welcoming refugees, about working on green spaces. And you develop new activities to reach new people, bringing more people into the life of the parish, with lots of suggestions on the website and so forth as well. This is the plan, and this is what we're going to turn our heads to in a moment. So the idea is one action and then two minor actions. One action and two minor actions and so forth. Get the idea? It's really simple, isn't it? It has to be, it's really simple. So it has to be simple. And it can take about 12, 20 months maybe. You just decide how long that's going to be. And then you put that into action. You collect evidence along the way of what you are doing. So it's important to have a sort of baseline of what you were doing before and what you are doing at the end. Collect evidence of what you've done. And you share that with the two assessors who come along, not going to me, it's going to be somebody else at the Catholic campaign team, asked to come along. And you just simply share it, and the evidence of, and they're not like, it's not like Ofsted or Investors for People, it's not like that, it's about you sharing your journey. Hopefully it's something that you might go on to do in a different way or build upon in the following year. Okay. That's the sort of award. It's made typically from a recycled church pew. Some people have done put panels. That's obviously a big action. Put panels on roofs. Lots of people involved in planting a garden. Walk to church Sunday is a marvellous thing. You're looking for sort of actions that can be easily organised, not take massive amounts of effort. And can be repeated if you want to repeat them. Does that make sense? It's a simple thing that you're trying to do, growing plants. In 50 years' time, it's going to be very hot here, so why not plant some trees? Those sorts of things.
Can I leave the parish?
Yeah.
Work ecumenically?
Yes, they do, yeah. And there are ways in which you could build, you might want in 12 months' time to bring the schools in. Both St Anne's and St Bede's maybe. That may be something. And there's evidence of that happening in the Lee area at the moment. Okay, the assessment bit I've mentioned very quickly. So the whole process, this is from a woman called Brenda Underwood from Brentwood. Been inspirational. Not knowing where to start, I feel we've come so far and done so much. I just encourage other groups to look and see, and you'll be surprised about how much you can achieve. And you celebrate, it's really important. There's a wee plaque at the end. And I say, you're not celebrating the plaque, you're celebrating what you've achieved. Okay. And there it is, there's a plaque. Okay. So we're going to just share some ideas. That's what we're going to do. I'm going to share some ideas. So what would you do? I've got here some Live Simply ideas. How many tables have we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8,
Well, that's about nine, isn't it? What I'm going to do is give you a little outline. It's so simple, and all you've got to do is talk about it. And you might say, what sort of action am I going to do? Is it reflection of worship? Because you want to drill that into some of it. When do you want to do it by? Be realistic about that. Who's going to be involved? Hopefully not just two or three people, but a few more. Bring in a few more suspects. Why are you doing? What's so important? Who's going to benefit from that's important? What will benefit? What difference will it make? And how are you going to show you succeeded? So that might be we're going to reduce the electricity or heating bill in a particular centre, and we can know that because we've got the previous heating from the previous year heating bill, and we can compare that with the following year. Or we're going to try and help vulnerable people in our parish get their houses more energy efficient. So we're going to help them with some insulation, try and access the insulation, and we're going to help them with some draft proofing. Simple things. Tell you, draft proof, if you can draft proof somebody's house, you'll save a fortune. It might be about Hawkwell. Live Simply has been around about 10 years, but was given a shot in the arm with Lad Out to see. If you want a copy of the Live Simply book, it probably says about £10 on that. I'm not bothered about that. Just you want to put a donation into the box over there. That's why the donation box is here. If you want to put a donation, that's fine. Right, let's get that's done with this. We want to hear some people's ideas. So let's start with Live Simply. And there are no wrong answers. No wrong answers at all. The purpose of this is to get some ideas flowing and to stimulate others. Okay. We thought we might get you to go along and give a tick at the end of the evening to things you particularly like. Okay. That's difficult because you're not going to say a great deal about it. But Live Simply. Let's start with this table here.
Well, one thing we've done here is minimise extravagance.
Okay.
By only what is truly needed.
Okay.
I think that's really simple, isn't it?
That sounds pretty good to me. Just buy what you need.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you. Alright. Do you want to carry on and do some others?
Well, no, I'm not going to monopolise the table, it's just...
No, it's not monopolising.
Anyone else here could read this.
No, that's fine.
They all came from various sources.
Of course, you know, as a spokesperson of the group.
Fair Trade Coffee.
Fair Trade Coffee? Yeah, yeah. FT Coffee.
Avoid waste.
Avoid waste.
Avoid waste, particularly being careful about sell by use by dates which are not particularly healthy. Some of these last a lot longer.
Okay, so things like food waste, proper information. Okay. Anything else on this table, listen?
Walk instead of driving.
Walk instead of driving. Great idea. Keeps you healthy. Meet people.
Carpooling.
Carpooling. Yeah. I think one good thinking about a walk to church Sunday. If we had a walk to church Sunday, then some people who couldn't walk could carpool. And if there's a rota, maybe, people who are willing to carpool.
Car sharing in parish, I think, well, is a particular form to put on this list. Car sharing within the parish, like,
yeah.
Rather than across Britain.
So car sharing is where you actually, not just on Sunday, you're actually sharing cars on a more regular basis.
I don't think there's any limit to.
No, okay. So, but people may not be familiar with that idea. You buy one car between two houses, say, for example.
That's a different dimension.
Okay. Anything else from this table on Simply?
Light bulbs,
energy saving
light bulbs. Yes? Thank you. Anything else?
Instead of throwing away food at the end of the day when it's past its sell-by date, feed the wildlife.
Feed the wildlife.
Or put some hams in.
Make soup. So, using leftovers, let's have some cookery classes.
make soup out of the bones of things.
Yes, much more famous. Let's have some thinking this table, live simply.
Well, some of the things were the similar, obviously. Yes. We've got the walk to church day.
Yeah.
For people who can, or cycle, maybe more cycle racks.
Yeah.
And
so some cycle racks as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Also, maybe parish walks to encourage people to walk.
Okay. So then sort of organised parish walks.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
And then we also went on to car sharing, but
yes,
maybe specifically lifts to Mass for people who can't get there.
Great idea,
and,
yes.
And there was, one of the ideas was lending and swapping things. I've got in my house things I don't want and I don't want to throw away, and if anybody wanted them, they could have them.
Yeah.
Now, there was a bit of a discussion on how to do this, whether we needed a central register of things and people could ring up and say what they wanted, or whether we could put up things in the church.
Like a wanted or
like a wanted, yes.
Surplus to
yes.
requirements.
So that one would be quite easy, or have a central register of it all.
Okay.
And then we had sharing of talents, helping people with gardening or decorating or things like that. If anybody wants to come and help us with decorating,
bring your own paint.
Thank you, that's really good. Anything else on the simply?
Yeah, we had a couple of things.
Yeah.
Developing one of the ideas from the previous group, we thought about how good it might be to promote healthy and simple eating through recipes and things, like shared, say, on Facebook or something like that. Because the healthy eating market is enormous, but its links with simple eating are actually quite obvious.
Yes.
Through vegetarian cookery and so on. So
yeah,
we thought about that. And we thought, well, how perhaps we could have a visual symbol of that by having some parish allotments.
Okay.
Oh.
We also spoke about the walking to church and obviously walking to school, which actually is burning far more fossil fuels than being going to church, sadly.
Yeah.
We did obviously very similar to a lot of the things that we just to include encouraging the children, gardeners from the parish, there must be a lot of gardeners, older gardeners, to encourage the children, perhaps there could be some liaison between the parishioners, the older parishioners and the children at school.
Yes.
And then with the DIY and things, so there must be a lot of parishioners who were very capable with DIY, who could help with draft roofing and then changing bulbs and all these things that some of our parishioners would struggle with. They could have something like, could be perhaps a register of type. I think everything else.
Yeah, I ran a scheme like that once. It does wonders.
Yeah.
Low level DIY.
Just the low level.
And it's just, it's a really friendly way. And people actually, you know, if you did things like helping people with their energy bills or switching an energy supplier, still most people in this country are paying for their gas
by
on a quarterly basis, and it's the most expensive way to do it. So you can do that. If somebody is local, is trusted, and they say, well, I've tried this, and it can be really effective.
Yeah, and a lot of talent, really.
We do. Yeah, absolutely.
People to share and go help with.
And it just brings people into contact with each other.
And the DIY and they're doing the jobs at the start, and they can practice on my house.
That's the first offer.
On DIY, I suggest that we people might grow their own vegetables.
Yes.
There's no waste with that.
No.
And it's nicer.
Yes.
It's very therapeutic. I did in my last parish to a person to stop.
I'll tell you a little story about the project that we ran a little while ago. We had a very good gardener, he was in his 70s, and one of the local project workers came along and had never grown a tomato. You can go to B&Q and you can buy a tomato plant, but you will never know how to grow a tomato until you ask somebody. You can read it, but whoever reads it, these books about, and all you get, of course, those who've never done it, is a bush of tomatoes, which are green and then turn red. So the only way that you will know how to grow a tomato is to talk to somebody who knows.
You
Has somebody told you, your dad told you, you're tricking out and all the rest of it. So there's an idea. All those people with all that expertise, clearly far above.
If you buy seeds, you always have loads more than you actually need, don't you? So then you could spread them around.
So seed back. Right, let's hear some sustainable ideas.
Renewable energy. We've got two types of solar in our places, and hot water and electricity.
So there might be people who've got experience of using solar in the parish who could perhaps encourage other people to. And again, advice, you're going to have a roof done. I wonder if that could be, that'd be quite an interesting project. Mary, do you want to say something?
We have a couple of things about providing information about how much energy you save if you didn't leave all your equipment on standby.
Okay.
And you actually switched it off. Or if you just reduce the temperature in your house by half a degree. What about using paper that's a lower quality, or unbleached paper, or recycled paper?
Double-sided printing,
or all the things you get through the post where people have only printed on one side. Encouraging people to use less bottled water, that's our water filters. Perhaps trying to promote people going vegetarian, a day a
week, going vegetarian,
one day a week, say, or swapping chicken for beef one day a week.
Yeah. Do you have a parish meal? If you get together, you might think about having vegetarian options or just vegetarian. Just a thought. I'm not a vegetarian myself. It does. It's a significant demonstration of support.
Well, we thought rather than saying go vegetarian, just to say perhaps one day
Small changes. I think an easy way to look at this is the idea of step down. So if you travel, let me put it this way, if you travel to London by air, could you go by train?
Or bus.
If you go to Liverpool by car, could you go on a train or could you cycle? No. Do you get the idea? And that means you don't have to do it all the time, but it's in the back of your mind about how I can reduce my carbon footprints. Instead of getting fruit from South Africa, could it be fruit from England? Those sorts of things. Just to get what I'm saying. It's not all with a straight guy. Some people will tell you actually you can use a lot of energy making or growing extra fruit in England, whereas actually if you grow in Kenya, fruit will ripen quicker, and you're just talking about the journey on. Anyway, there's a very good book called Bananas or How Bad Are Bananas by Mike Berners-Lee. Anyway, okay.
Would you don't want to put fair trade out of business, do you?
No, we don't want to put fair trade. Okay, so we're saying, Mary, any more time? Okay, any more sustainable?
Think about how often you use your washing machine, your dishwasher, your dryer.
Yeah. Okay.
I've been a nice little lazy one.
Yes.
We're going to have to spend a lot of money on the church roof soon.
Yes.
Could we investigate whether solar panels could be incorporated?
That'd be an interesting idea. Yeah.
Now, there's a big one.
It's a big one. That's a big project.
Especially in a listed building.
Yes.
But is it possible?
Yes. Maybe possible. You just need a heritage office. And lots of money. Yes.
Is there any way of returning postage and papers? We get papers regularly, largely advertising. Is there any way of immediately returning them and that we inundate them with a lot of junk?
There's the mail preference service arm, and you can stop getting it in the first place.
How do you do that? I mean, just we seem to get stuff regularly, which we don't particularly want, and it goes in the bin.
Yes.
If you cross it out, put return to sender with deceased on it. It's actually very effective.
Yes. Yes.
One solicitor.
They have to pay for it. They soon stop sending.
Sorry, Bonham says that if you
if you cross it out and put all the solicitors on, that's another benefit. Because then they have to pay for it. But the mail preference service, you can go online and put your address into the mail preference service, and also the yes.
So they're not
addressed
to you,
no.
But they're from.
It's a good way to prevention. Any more on sustainable? Sustainability, anybody? Okay. Let's go to solidarity.
Well, we're in the process of seeing what we can do to help to assist refugees who live within the parish. That's
fantastic.
In embryonic stage at the moment, but it takes time.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, and that would be my big.
Yeah, and you're in good. Okay. I mean, talking about solidarity, you're in good company there with lots of other parishes that try and do the same, and being in solidarity with them will also help.
If I could just sort of take the next step from that, because we sort of looked at the same area, and you talk about stepping down.
Yes.
I think perhaps this is one of the areas where you can regularly step down. Mac looked at a government scheme for sort of, say, a parish buying a house and running it, and what was involved was horrendous. You know, you, as a parish, to organise would just be. But then the archdiocese are looking at putting this scheme together. So perhaps rather than trying to run our own, we actually look at having an input into other areas, either as individuals or possibly better as groups. So for example, our prayer group, there's a lot of wish there to do something at the help. The UCM, you've got a lot of people who could have, put their talents towards various sides of doing that. And I think it also gives you a solidarity within the parish then. Rather than having two or three well-intentioned and very busy people running all over the place, if you spread it out, it sort of becomes a bit of almost a club within the parish who are helping outside. And there's an organisation in Liverpool called Morang, the UCM were involved in that.
Yes.
My daughter's school was.
Yes.
Yeah, and you are then getting children involved in helping to mothers who are having. So again, it had a sort of R factor to it.
Yeah.
And they got a wonderful response.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that's an area where really a solidarity comes in. And then it doesn't necessarily have to be just on the refugee front, although there's a lot of scope there. But the homeless, we were talking at our table, and we have homeless people in Ormskirk. I never knew. It isn't something which is normally sort of talked about. You don't see them all over the place like you would in Liverpool. But again, perhaps if you've got the right contact, a lady coming in. Maybe this wanted to talk about what's happening with refugees in West Lancashire. Presumably there's also some sort of organisation for the homeless.
Okay.
So really it's just whether you talk about not wasting food, but if you do buy it and you don't use it, is that somewhere where it could be?
Okay, some practical things there, Peter. So,
yeah.
I mean, all of those are areas of also quite significant new development for the parish. It's great that you're looking at that. You also need to make sure that you are deepening your understanding, and so that because there are challenges to that, and if you're not able to deepen why you're doing it, and you're acting out of love, you're acting out of what you want to do to respond to the Lord's wishes, then I think you will struggle. So make sure that you keep that spiritual aspect of this going, that theological aspect of this going. Whether it be the Lambeth Use of Cross, with the UCM or whatever, that's a crucial part of that. Any last things on solidarity? Because
it would be great if we could.
There's
this pie in the sky, but to use this centre to feed the homeless, maybe even just once a week, a soup kitchen.
Yeah, there's a vision. Yeah, there's isn't it?
Well, they do it at the parish church, don't they?
Yeah. So we know there'll be so many people will be happy to do that. Even that one thing.
Yes. I know it's easier if it's shared and it's simple.
Yeah.
Okay. Lovely. Great ideas. Really great ideas. We're not going to be short of ideas, I can see that. This is fantastic. Susan, do you want to say anything in particular at this point?
I don't think so. I mean, we've got everything written down here, and if people would be willing to put the contact details down, and maybe it needs to be scribbled by what your idea was, and then we can always ring people, because there's so many good ideas, and it's a good opportunity to get people together. One thing to have occurred to me was whether it'd be a good idea at some point, oops, to have a sort of ideas fair, almost, a bit like a trade fair, where you could say, I've changed over to renewable supply, and it was no trouble, why not try it? Or all the various things people have been suggesting, you've actually liked Will's idea about fending off the unwanted mail, things like that. If you could tell people what we know already, other people could try it out. But you need a forum for doing it.
Yes.
We are going to have a little space on the parish website, and I finally sent something to Steve Dolan. So again, if there are ideas, send them to him, and he can put them up, or put them in the bulletin. We thought we have a little box in the bulletin for this week's good idea. I think people will find that useful.
Well, not everybody.
You want everybody.
Including a prayer, maybe supporting the meeting if we can, but doing something, preferably doing something positive rather than giving up. If that positive then means as a result we've given up something and give that to the poor, but really to take up something like buying local vegetables or whatever it might be, or have one main meal a day and just two small meals, whatever it might be, but something on the live simply, but taking up rather than giving up. Would be a possible Lenten exercise. I'm not saying seriously, and I'm not sure I'm going to do it myself. I never attended one around here.
That sounds like an excellent suggestion, if I may say. Sorry about this, I'm just trying to connect this so we can play the tune in that. Okay. So the idea of using Lent to live simple, focus on this symptom. Yeah, that sounds good. I think some of the next steps, or one of the next steps, is to bring some ideas together. I would suggest that you try to share those ideas with as many people in the parish as possible. Having some sort of voting system where people just come along and they tick, well, like that and like that. You don't have to have 9, you can have 20 now, but it has to be doable. What I'm saying, there is not something that's magical about the number 9. As long as it's manageable for yourselves, and it's in your back to manage yourself. Okay.
I mean, I can type all these up and put them in the bulletin, or attach them to the bulletin.
Okay. And there's a core group. So who is on the core group?
Well, there's Pat, there's Margaret, there's me, there's Terry, there's Black Margaret, and Zyla, there's myself, Dan Barton, and Pam, yes. So that's, I think,
we've
got anybody else.
Well, our thanks to you all, for sure, because it does need some coordination. I'm sure you'll think about how that's going. One of the key things I would encourage you to think about is how you communicate it, so that it doesn't seem like it's series of stop-starts. But as you mentioned before, how people are going to feedback what they do, that is a part of the notice board, which is live simply, or part of the website, which just keeps people aware.
There's a notice board in the porch, and there's a notice board here as well.
Well, let's just go back to the presentation for a moment. We've done some feedback, and we've talked about next steps. Does anybody have any particular thoughts that they want to share with us before we go into a closing prayer?
Just one of the suggestions that I've heard, which somebody who isn't here, is
there's so much information around about things like solar panels versus whatever, that if we could, I think Anne mentioned it to you, that if we had some way of, say, once a month in the bulletin, attachment to the bulletin or something, saying, what's the difference between, for argument's sake, refugees and asylum seekers and immigrants? What's the difference between the various types of light bulbs? Because we keep getting told as to what we should do, and then you go to the shop and you think, I don't know where to stop.
Yes.
So it's just something.
It is often very
practical.
There's so
many other things that people get confused over. There's so much information. How do we make it down to eatable size?
And if you have one or two people that were prepared to take that on and do a bit of research. You know, very often, this project I mentioned before, we had somebody who said, you know, you need a particular sort of light bulb, you need to go to B&Q, aisle 27, and it's there, it's £5.99. That's what, that's actually what you need. Or there's a web link, you know, you can do that.
Yes.
But it, we've used it, and it's good. You know, it lasts, and you know, it's cheap and so forth.
Right.
So.
There is the ideas box in the porch as well, as sometimes you could do off of Lady Elizabeth. If you have got the idea, it's like a little letterbox, just stick it in there. That's the other thing. If somebody does know, this is a really good place to buy low energy light bulbs, exactly as you say, stick it in there and then we can publicise it.
As you're moving about the house, you decide that you leave one room, and you say you decide, I'll turn the light off before I switch another one on. Are you using more energy by turning lights on and off?
No.
I guess you can use
a Facebook page, or for those who don't know how to do that, you can simply have a piece of the, or a notice board as well, that's really sad, in the church, so people can keep ideas and share them. What I would say to you is, don't go away and think, I've done my bit now. Think, actually, what can I do? What can I contribute to take this forward? And that might be a little thing, but all those little things add up.
We have a sort of soup meeting one every month, or a gardening meeting.
Yes, something like that. Just somebody pull the ideas. Even if three people turn up, it's great.
Here's a more immediate idea. Concurrently turning the side of praying and asking for guidance of the Holy Spirit. On Friday of this week, we have the Lampedusa Cross coming. We're having the stations of the Lampedusa Cross instead of our normal stations in Lent at 7 o'clock on Friday evening. As many people can join us for that as possible, would be a very good way, because it's very much connected with the refugees, the migrants, and all the need to make what we have go around a bit more fairly.
Indeed. And I would say, there's people around here that know better than I do, that the service is probably the only civil service I've come across where we are in a Catholic context and we're reflecting deeply on what it is to be a refugee and a migrant. And be able to share that afterwards over a cup of tea. I think it's so simple, so beautiful. Thank you. Let's let people go. I'm going to, having said that, to take that little bit home with you about what can I do. I don't want you to feel that you're overly responsible. So we're going to go to the closing prayer, which is the Romero prayer, which I think we used last June when I was here last. I'm going to just play some music.
Thank you.
show the slide, final prayer, final slide, please, that you've got a prayer for.
Heavenly Father, all men are created equal in your sight. You cause your sun to rise on all men, and your rain to fall on all men, without distinction. In your providence you provide that all should have enough for their needs. Help us to live simply, sustainably, and in solidarity with our brothers and sisters, so that your precious gifts may be shared and consumed faithfully. That no one takes more at the cost of another having insufficient for their needs. That no one benefits from another's pain. Help us, Lord, in our homes, parishes, and personal lives to strive to achieve the equality that you intended in your plan. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Peter. Thanks to you all, to Susan, and the rest of the group for putting this together for us. It's been a real pleasure being here again with you. That says it all to me, an opportunity for God's grace to enter and to do the best. We do what we can, but we are not the master builders, we are the workers.
I think my God has gone, so can I just thank you on behalf of us all for coming and setting us off on this movement.
Thank you.